Dear viewers, we have seen many issues like opportunities for dairy farming, breeds of cows and buffaloes, dairy management, production of clean milk, etc. in the first part of this film. The second part will visualize fodder species, varieties and their cultivation, silage making, production of cattle feed on the farm, diseases, dairy machineries and equipment, etc. in detail. Milk for home use and manure for crops was a simple reason for keeping dairy animals from centuries in sustainable farming system. But now, the milk production gained commercial importance due to the uncertainty of income from crop production. Unlike other agricultural products, milk gets a short price and year-round demand. However, dairy is also facing many problems in recent years. Price for the milk is not going up, matching to the price hike for cattle feed and other inputs. Income generated by selling milk is spent entirely for feeding the animals itself. Over-dependence on ready cattle feed has created this situation. Milk production and productivity has come down by ignoring green grass and leguminous fodder. Even today, many traditional farmers depend entirely on paddy straw to feed their dairy animals. This affects both milk yield and the health of the animal. Realizing this mistake, fodder cultivation is given necessary importance in planning new dairy projects now. Dairy animal needs food 2.5 to 3.5% of its body weight. In other words, a buffalo of this size needs 30 kilograms and a cow needs 25 kilograms of food including concentrates. It should have 60% wet and 40% dry fodder. Out of total green wet fodder, 25% must be from leguminous species and 75% from monocot grasses. Dry fodder is a must, even if we have surplus of green fodder. Feeding only green will affect the growth of the animal and the yield and quality of milk. Do not use paddy straw as dry fodder. The oxalic acid content in it will deplete the calcium from the body of the animal. Finger millet and sorghum stubbles, wheat straw, dicot gram herbage, etc. are the best fodders. Among monocot green grasses, Napier Bajra hybrids, pearl millet, fodder maize, guinea grass, perennial sorghum, Rhodes grass, etc. are the important ones. Proteinaceous legume include fodder cowpea, sun hemp, horse gram, lucerne, hedge lucerne, styloxanthus, azolla, etc. Apart from these, tree fodders like subabul, lyricidia, sesbenia, caliandra, coral tree, ficus, mulberry, jackfruit, bauhinia, melia, etc. are the useful ones. Provide enough fodder only twice a day, that is in the morning and evening. Feeding throughout the day will affect mastication and the digestion will not be proper, leading to the wastage of the food. This affects the growth as well as the milk yield. Chop both green and dry fodder to half-inch length before feeding. Otherwise, the animal will eat only leaves, leaving behind the nutritious stem portion. Provide concentrated cattle feed depending on the quality of fodder given. If both green grass and legumes are fed, less quantity of cattle feed is sufficient. Normally, production of 1 liter of milk needs 500 grams of balanced cattle feed. Of course, the pregnant animal needs 1 kilogram extra. Put 100 grams of mineral mixture also. Apart from these, give 50 grams each of calcium powder and common salt per animal per day in heavy rainfall areas. Normally, the feed mixture is soaked in the water for 12 hours and fed. This farmer soaks the feed in boiling water for 2 hours before feeding. This facilitates easy digestion and minimizes fungal contaminants. Cattle feeds of many brands of different qualities are available in the open market. But the cost of this will not work out for bigger dairies. Instead, feed mixture is prepared on the farm itself by mixing ingredients of good quality. This assures nutrient content with less cost. Moisture content of the feed mixture should not be too much, otherwise the fungal contaminants may grow, affecting the health of the animal. Hence, feed mixture is prepared once in a week in big dairies and once in a month in smaller dairies. Let the ingredients be like this: broken cereal grains 45%, rice or wheat bran 30%, oil seed cake 20%, mineral mixture 2%, urea 1%, and common salt 2%. This is a general formula. Buffalo needs additional oil seed cake since the fat content of the milk is more. Maize, sorghum, pearl millet, finger millet, little millet, foxtail millet, etc. are used as a source of carbohydrate. Seed cakes of groundnut, cotton, soya bean, sunflower, dicot gram waste, bran, fish powder, etc. are the good source of protein. The grains may differ from area to area and season to season, depending on the availability and market rate. But do not alter the proportion of carbohydrate, fat, and protein. Feed having bypass protein is still better. Few dairies use barley husk brought from wine factories. Food alone constitutes 70% of the operational cost of a dairy farm. Hence, calculative feed management will bring more profit. Now it is the time to learn more about green fodder. Most of the fodder species are rain-fed crops, but irrigation is necessary for higher and continuous fodder yield. We can preserve green fodder in the form of silage in the rainy season when it is in surplus. However, most of the dairies use fresh green fodder itself, even though the silage has many advantages. Now there are many high-yielding and good quality fodder crops and varieties. The good fodder grass should be smooth enough and without much hairs. Wide leaf blade and less stem portion are preferred. It should not become coarse even if the harvesting is delayed. It should not have negative substances like oxalic acid. Once planted, should give good fodder yield for 3 to 4 years. Hybrid Napier stands first by considering all these criteria. It is a hybrid of elephant grass for higher yield and Bajra for better quality. It gives highest yield with good manuring and irrigation, but it cannot survive in dry land. Oxalic acid is present up to 6 weeks of growth. It is necessary to chop it before feeding due to the thick stem. Hybrid Napier is not useful as dry fodder. It produces no seed. Hence, it is multiplied by stem cuttings or root slips. NB hybrid grass is equally suitable for silage making also. This is Yashwant Napier. Planting once will give a good yield for 5 years. It grows to a height of 8 to 10 feet and comes to harvest once in 60 days. This farmer does not give any manure or fertilizer. Instead, cow dung slurry, urine, and water from shed washing are given. Few farmers give top dressing dose of urea after each harvest. This Yashwant Napier can produce 40 tons of green fodder per acre per year. This is CO1, a perennial multi-cut NB hybrid. 16,000 root slips are necessary for 1 acre. Give interrow spacing of 2 feet. It comes for harvest once in 45 to 50 days. Irrigated crop gives 6 to 8 cuttings and 40 tons of green fodder per year. Harvesting at half feet height above the ground will facilitate good regrowth by tillering. CO1 can be identified easily by its light yellow ear heads. This parrot green grass is CO3 variety. One more popular NB hybrid liked by the farmers is CO4. Dark green color, broad leaf blade and thick stem make it easy for identification. It grows to a height of 6 to 8 feet and available for harvest once in 45 to 50 days. Putting slurry or urea after each harvest gives excellent growth. Irrigate once in 15 days. The yield potential of CO4 variety is 45 to 50 tons per acre. This is another NB hybrid, BH18. Plow the land thoroughly and plant the root slips with an interrow spacing of 2 feet. Regular irrigation and manuring will bring 6 to 8 harvests per year. BH18 grows to a height of 8 to 10 feet and gives 40 tons of green fodder per acre. This variety can be identified by purple colored ear heads and light red colored stems. This is APBN or Andhra Pradesh Bajra Napier hybrid variety. 16,000 root slips are necessary for 1 acre. Plow the land thoroughly with enough organic manure. Give a spacing of 2 into 2 feet. Irrigate once in 15 days. It grows to a height of 8 to 10 feet and produces 45 tons of fodder per acre per year. The stem of APBN variety is very soft. Likewise, many Napier Bajra hybrids are found in different parts of the country. Most of them are similar in basic nature, fodder quality and yield, with slight differences. Nowadays, these NB hybrids have become compulsory to fulfill the fodder needs of commercial dairies. This is Guinea grass, which grows very well even under partial shades of plantations. Guinea has three major varieties. This is Guinea Hemel. This grass has a substance which improves milk yield. This grass is comparatively small in size, but gives 30 tons fodder per acre per year. Sheep and goat like this Guinea grass very much. 5 to 6 kilograms of seed is necessary for 1 acre. It can be multiplied even by root slips. Sow the seeds in the seed beds and plant the seedlings of 25 to 30 days in the main field. Otherwise, sow the seeds directly. Leaf portion is more than the stem, hence feeding without chopping is possible. This is perennial multicut sorghum, a hybrid between Sudan grass and sorghum. This being a drought-tolerant species, survives even in severe dry conditions and gives off new flush again in the rainy season. It has thin stem and more leaf portion. This multicut sorghum is multiplied by seeds and regrowth is by tillers. It needs 15 to 20 kilograms of seed per acre. Give an interrow spacing of 2 feet. Harvest the crop at milk grain stage. Keep 2 to 3 inches of the stem on ground to facilitate regrowth. This grass is useful as green or dry fodder and also for silage making. We get 3 to 4 harvests per year and 15 tons of green fodder per harvest per acre. Irrigated crop gives a better yield even though it is a rain-fed grass species. This is fodder maize. The variety is African tall, which grows to a height of 8 to 10 feet. Plow the land thoroughly with sufficient organic manure. Sow the seeds in rows with an interrow spacing of 1.5 feet. It needs 25 kilograms of seed per acre. Cultivation of fodder maize is possible throughout the year under irrigation. This is a palatable and smooth fodder. However, the stem is very thick and needs chopping before feeding. It becomes coarse if not harvested within 90 days. Each crop gives 20 tons of fodder per acre. Fodder maize improves milk yield. This is Rhodes grass, a preferred fodder for stall-fed goat and sheep. It is useful even as a dry fodder. Goat feeding on Rhodes grass conceives early and gives more milk. It has more calcium, which strengthens the bones. Hence, the calves grow fast. Rhodes grass, especially used for race horses and bulls, maintained for semen collection. 5 kilograms of seed is necessary for 1 acre. It is multiplied by root slips also. In addition, it roots at nodes and spreads to adjacent area. It grows to a height of 6 to 8 feet and available for harvest once in 40 days. There are 2-3 varieties in this Rhodes grass. This is paragrass. It has hairs on leaves and stem, but it is no way inferior in nutrients than other species. Normally, it is not cultivated on the farm. It is seen growing along the sewage canals of big cities. This is the main fodder for the animals in Bangalore city. The stem of the paragrass is very soft. It is liked very much by buffaloes. Basically, most of the fodder species are rain-fed grasses. However, we get higher yield around the year with regular irrigation and application of organic manures and fertilizers. The general fertilizer recommendation for these fodder grasses is 40 kilograms of nitrogen, 30 kilograms of phosphorus, and 16 kilograms of potash per acre. Apply half of the recommended nitrogen as basal dose and the remaining half as top dressing after harvest. Most of the dairies use dung, slurry, and urine available in plenty on their farm. Water from the cattle shed washing is flooded to the fodder crop. Green fodder in 1 acre can feed 8 to 10 big animals. Let us study leguminous fodders now. This is sun hemp, which is popular both for fodder and green manuring. It is commonly grown with the residual moisture of the paddy field after harvest. This, being a leguminous plant, has more protein and improves soil fertility by nitrogen fixation. It needs 15 to 20 kilograms of seed per acre. No necessity of top dressing fertilizer. Harvest the crop at 35 to 40 days stage and use it as a green or dry fodder. Do not feed this to the animals after flowering, since it has a negative substance called HCN. Harvest at 1 foot above the ground to facilitate regrowth. Sun hemp is a proteinaceous and palatable fodder, good for goat and sheep also. This is lucerne, a soft and nutritious fodder with 15 to 22% of protein. Feeding lucerne will overcome the problem of pregnancy failure in dairy animals. Prolactin content in this plant improves milk yield. This is an irrigated crop. 2 to 3 kilograms of seed is necessary for 1 acre. Seed germinates only in winter. The crop once sown gives good fodder yield for 2 to 3 years. It comes for harvest once in 20 days, so that 8 to 10 harvest is possible per year. Well-drained soil is necessary. It will not come up well in acidic soil. Lucerne is equally suitable for leaf meal production also. This is hedge lucerne, another leguminous plant normally grown on hedge or fence. Seed treatment with hot water is necessary for better germination. Crop sown once gives good yield for 7 to 8 years. It grows to a height of 7 to 8 feet and gets ready for harvest once in 35 to 40 days. It withstands repeated harvest. Hedge lucerne with high amount of protein is equally good as dry fodder also. Sheep and goat like this very much. Another important leguminous fodder is Stylosanthus. It grows very well in wastelands and improves the soil fertility by nitrogen fixation. It is most suitable for soil and water conservation as a mulch crop and a good species for bund stabilization. Stylosanthus hemata is more popular than three other regular species of the genus. It grows very well in competition with the weeds and suppresses them. It spreads to the whole area by self-seeding. 2 to 3 kilograms of seed is necessary for 1 acre. Maximum germination is up to 40%. The small seed will not germinate if sown deeper than 0.5 centimeter. For better germination, put the seed in boiling water for 10 minutes, drain, dry under shade, and sow. Stylosanthus, with 18 to 22% protein, is equally suitable for leaf meal production. It is available for harvest 4 to 5 times a year. This is very popular in pastures with grass species. The sticky substance oozing out from its leaves has anti-tick properties. Hence, the animal grazing on Stylosanthus will not have ticks. This is velvet bean creeper. This is very popular as a cover crop in coconut, areca nut, and rubber plantations under organic farming. It minimizes soil erosion and enriches the soil by nitrogen fixation. Seed dibbled in June gives 2 harvest of herbage in September to October. It is rich in nutrients even though the volume is less. Velvet bean creeper climbing on a tree will give 4 to 5 kilograms of seed, which can be fed to the animals like cattle feed. We can give 1 to 2 kilograms of this per animal per day. Growing velvet bean with fodder sorghum is also in practice. All these leguminous crops need less nitrogen since they fix it from the atmosphere. However, it needs more phosphorus for better nitrogen fixation. Hence, the general fertilizer recommendation is 8 kilograms of nitrogen, 32 kilograms of phosphorus, and 16 kilograms of potash per acre. This is another proteinaceous fodder, Azolla, becoming popular in recent years. This aquatic plant hosts blue-green algae called Anabena on the edges of the leaves, which fixes atmospheric nitrogen. Growing Azolla in paddy fields for green manuring is in practice. This is an excellent proteinaceous fodder also. It is cultivated successfully in water tanks with 1 foot depth. Add cow dung to the tank as food for Azolla. Partial shade is also necessary for its good growth. It multiplies and spreads very fast, even if a portion of it is taken out every day. Collect it from the pond, wash with clean water, mix it with cattle feed, and feed to the animals. Azolla may be fed to an animal 2 to 3 kilograms a day. It improves the milk yield and brings down the dependence on the cattle feed. Changing of water in the tank once in a month is advised. People without enough space for fodder cultivation can go for Azolla. However, Azolla is not yet popular in commercial dairies. Even the poultry birds like feeding Azolla. Let us study tree fodders now. Normally, the field fodder crops produce lower yield in hot summer. Situation will be still worse in drought years. Perennial tree fodders can compensate the shortage. Hence, it is advised to grow leguminous fodder bushes and trees along the fens, on the buns, and in barren portions of the farm. These deep-rooted plants can give fodder round the year without irrigation. This is Subabul, introduced in the 80s. This is the most popular and the best tree fodder. Subabul is an agroforestry tree species popular even for green manuring, firewood and wood pulp for the industry. It comes up well in low rainfall areas and grows very slowly in heavy rainfall areas. Herbage from the big Subabul tree has a negative substance called mimosine, which may create problems in pregnant animals. Hence, keep on lopping the plant at 5 to 6 feet for fodder. It withstands repeated lopping. Harvest the branches before flowering. Otherwise, it may grow like a weed on the farm by self-seeding. Subabul is suitable for leaf meal production also. This is Kaliandra, a leguminous plant species from Indonesia. This is useful for fodder, green manuring, and firewood. Kaliandra is a soft, palatable, and proteinaceous fodder. It is multiplied by seeds. It withstands repeated lopping and is available for cutting 3 to 4 times a year. However, continuous feeding of Kaliandra on a large scale will create infertility in dairy animals. Hence, restricted to 5 kilograms per animal per day. Gliricidia is another common leguminous fodder, rich in protein. It is seen growing along the fences and bunds of the farms. The stem is thick and hard, which needs chopping before feeding. Gliricidia, just cut, has some bad odor disliked by the animals. Hence, wilt it for some time and feed. It needs a few days for the animals to like feeding Gliricidia. Sesbinia is another proteinaceous and palatable fodder. This is popular as a support and shade plant for beetle vines and also as a windbreaker in banana plantations. It withstands repeated lopping and gives out good regrowth. Regular irrigation gives higher yield of fodder. Likewise, mulberry is also a popular green fodder in its traditional bells. Stem is hard and chopping is necessary before feeding. However, continuous feeding of mulberry on a large scale will lead to infertility and low milk yield. Hence, restrict it to 2 to 3 kilograms per animal per day. Traditionally, there are many tree fodders in use for sheep and goat. Bahunya is one among them. This will not produce seeds. Multiplication is by planting stem cuttings. Likewise, rain tree, an avenue tree planted on the roadside, is also a good leguminous fodder species. Buffaloes like the tender leaves of this rain tree very much. Abundantly available pods of this tree can also be fed to the animals. Melia is another popular fodder tree in the villages. Tender leaves and fruits are given to sheep, goat, and other cattle. It withstands repeated lopping. This popular agroforestry tree grows very fast. Apart from these, jackfruit is one more nutritious fodder. Leaves, tender fruits, and ripened fruits may be fed on a small scale. Likewise, herbage and fruits of fig is also in use as fodder. 5 kilograms of tree fodder is recommended per animal per day. In traditional Arakanat area, leaf sheath is used as fodder. It is chopped, dried, and fed to the animals. Farmers' experience indicates the improvement of milk fat by feeding Arakanat leaf sheath. However, feeding the wet sheath may create problems in mastication since it has a thin upper layer like plastic. Likewise, cocoa farmers feed cocoa fruit rind to the dairy animals after extracting the beans inside. We can conclude that without using green, nutritious, monocot and dicot fodders, dairying cannot be a viable profession. Fodder crops play a vital role in the successful continuation of dairy units despite the sharp price hike of cattle feeds. Now we will understand the method of silage making. Even though it is a good technology released decades ago, we find silage making mostly in stall-fed goat and sheep farms only. Silage making is a systematic and scientific method of preservation of nutritious green fodder with sufficient sugar content. Regular yellow maize is grown for this purpose on commercial farms. Otherwise, any fodder species with high sugar content, like fodder sorghum varieties, SSV73, PVK01, etc., are also good for silage. Even the green fodders like CO1, AP01, Guinea, etc., may be utilized for this purpose. But we need to add 2 kg of jaggery per ton of fodder since they have less sugar content. Growth of useful microorganisms and fermentation of the fodder needs comfortable sugar content. However, the silage from these green fodders will be slightly inferior in quality due to absence of grains. Big farmers producing silage grow yellow maize of regular variety for this purpose. The crop is harvested with cobs at 85 days when the milk grain stage is just over. Few farmers construct stone chambers above the ground like this for silage making. For small scale production, even the plastic barrels are in use. This farmer has dug pits for this purpose. Another farmer used granite slab for the walls of the silo pit. This helps to prevent rats and mice entering the pit. However, mud pit is not a problem. Anyway, we need to spread thick plastic sheet for the entire pit, even if it has granite slab walls. Plastic is necessary to prevent rainwater and air entering the silo pit. It is also important to avoid evaporation of moisture from the silage. Technically speaking, silage making is a process of anaerobic fermentation of green fodder. So the silage gets spoiled if the air enters the silo pit. Whichever may be the fodder variety, harvest the crop with the grains. Chop the fodder in the cutter machine to 1/4-inch length. It is made to fall in the pit directly. Adding leguminous fodder to this will enrich the nutritional value of the silage. Put 150 liters of water in a barrel and dissolve 20 kilograms of jaggery. Take 50 liters of water in another tub. Add 250 grams of silage microorganism culture to it. This culture is available with few private laboratories. 1 kilogram of this culture costs about 15,000 rupees and is enough for 100 tons of silage. This is most important for better fermentation and easy digestion of the silage. Now pour the culture solution into the barrel containing jaggery water and mix it thoroughly. Spray the solution at the rate of 10 liters per ton of chopped fodder. Here the culture solution is placed in the tub put on this platform. A drip pipe attached to the bottom of the tub reaches the solution to the chopped fodder. A small tap controls the flow of the solution. 1 kilogram of common salt per ton of fodder is also added. Complete the filling of the silo pit on the same day. Do not continue the work for the next day. Compact the chopped fodder falling into the pit at each layer by trampling by clean bare feet. This is necessary to take out air in between. Cover the whole mass in the pit by a plastic sheet after the completion of filling of the fodder. Place stones or sandbags as weight on the silo pit. A pit having 20 tons of fodder needs 5 tons of weight on the top. Provide roofing to the silo pit to prevent rainwater entering inside. Avoid rats and mice burrowing the pit. Otherwise, it leads to aeration and development of insect larvae inside, spoiling the silage. The fodder turns into silage in 15 days and gets ready for feeding. Silage keeps good for 2 years. Size of chopping, amount of trampling, the weight put on the pit, etc., decide the quality of the silage produced. Silage is a nutritious, palatable wet fodder for cows, buffaloes, sheep, and goat. One cubic foot volume of the silo pit holds 12 to 15 kilograms of silage. This pit is 30 feet long, 6 feet wide, and 10 feet deep, or in other words, 1,800 cubic feet in volume. This can accommodate 25 to 30 tons of silage. It is difficult to take out the silage if the depth is more. Do not take out entire plastic cover and wait while getting the silage for feeding. Instead, exhaust 1 or 2 feet width from top to bottom. Opening like this needs perfect repacking. This silage has about 10% grains by weight since it is cut along with cobs. Hence, the animals feeding the silage need less cattle feed. Animals can digest the silage even if they eat more. Silage making brings down daily labor requirement for fodder management. Silage has more available nutrients than the same green fodder. In spite of all these advantages, silage is not yet very popular among dairy farmers of India. National Institute of Animal Nutrition and Physiology, Bangalore has developed a technology called Complete Feed Block. Here they prepare feed blocks from a mixture of dry fodder and cattle feed mixed in required proportion. Fodder may be straw, any crop residue, or dry leaves of fodder trees. For cattle with an average milk yield, feed block is prepared with 60% dry fodder and 40% concentrated cattle feed. Add molasses, 7 to 10% by weight of the total material used to keep the block intact. For using green grass or leaves, dry them under the shade before mixing. Otherwise, the block may be spoiled by fungal infection. The mixture is filled in the box of this hydraulic machine and subjected to 3000 to 4000 psi pressure. This complete feed block remains unspoiled for 1 year if stored in a dry place. The animals like this feed block due to its palatability. 4 to 5 feed blocks may be fed to a big animal per day. This machine runs with 7 HP 3-phase electric motor. It costs about 5 lakh rupees. However, this being a manually operated machine, can produce hardly 25 to 35 blocks per hour. This machine may be established in dairy societies for community usage. Feeding this block increases food intake of the animal, and hence the body growth and milk yield goes up. Complete feed block reduces the space needed for fodder storage. It makes transportation less bulky and easy. Let us study the dairy machineries and equipment now. The most important one is motorized milking machine. Manual equipment of the same type is also available, but it needs continuous manual work and it is not suitable for bigger dairies. This powered milking machine runs with 1.5 HP single-phase electric compressor. There are different models with which one can milk with 1, 2, 3, or 4 milking cans simultaneously. It is better to keep oil engine or an electricity generator to run the milking machine at the time of power cut. The vacuum generated by the compressor is available along the length of the cattle shed by this airtight PVC pipeline. This pipe has T's and cocks at regular intervals to facilitate attaching milking cans. When this cock is opened, the vacuum gets connected with this airtight milking can. Clean the udder of the cow as usual. Put the milking tubes to the tits. It fits and holds itself firmly due to the vacuum. These milking tubes press the tits like this and take the milk out, but not by sucking. The milk flows to the can through this transparent plastic tube, which we can see now clearly. Hold the milking tubes pulled down gently when the milk flow recedes. It takes out leftover milk in the udder. Delay in detaching the tubes will not create any problem. The blood will never come out, as many innocent farmers suspect. A single person can milk with 2 cans in this machine. Working with bigger machine, milking 4 cows at a time needs 2 people. We can milk 8 cows with 10 to 12 liters of milk with 1 can in 1 hour comfortably. This machine completes milking in the specified time of 6 to 7 minutes from an animal with any amount of milk. This increases the milk yield by 10%. There will be no pressure or damage to the udder muscles with machine milking. Clean and complete milking prevents the chance of mastitis. Milk remains unspoiled for 2 to 3 hours as the air contact of the milk is left. Clean all these tubes and the cans after every milking by sucking hot water. Clean them again by using soap powder and cold water. Any negligence in this cleaning will spoil the milk of next milking. The spare parts of this milking machine are quite durable. However, we need to replace the milking tube cluster once in 2 years, which costs around 1,200 rupees. This milking machine is hardly seen in buffalo dairies, even though it is equally suitable for buffaloes. Compressor and one milking can set costs about 60,000 rupees now. Each additional set of can and its accessories cost 25,000 rupees. We can conclude that this electric milking machine is quite essential for timely, clean and easy milking in commercial dairies. Its contribution is quite evident in the success of the dairy units. Another important machine of the dairy is fodder chopping machine. Farmers were using manual equipment earlier. Now we have many models of this motorized machine of various capacities. Bigger dairies use diesel engine fodder chopping machines. It can be operated by the power from the PTO shaft of the tractor also. Fit two cutting blades to the flywheel and chop the fodder into small pieces. This enables better digestion and complete usage of the fodder. Another important equipment of the dairy is the compressor for washing cattle shed. Water coming out with high pressure can remove dried dung and urine also. It needs less water compared to manual cleaning. Using compressor for washing the shed and for bathing of the animal eliminates ticks from the dairy. Now we find portable high pressure washers also in smaller dairies. This runs with 2 kilowatt single phase electricity. All these machines bring down the labor requirement on the dairy farm. Hence, it reduces the cost of operation and makes the work easy and fast. Let us know about the biogas unit now. Normally, the dung available abundantly on the dairy farm is put directly into the manure pit. It leads to the wastage of the valuable biogas in the dung. The biogas is useful for cooking, lighting, and also for running a diesel engine. The slurry coming out of the biogas unit has a higher amount of available nutrients than the original dung. It is wrong to imagine by the traditional farmers that it is inferior in nutrients. KVIC and Dinabandhu are the two popular models of biogas plant. This plant with floating biogas collection drum is the KVIC model. Dinabandhu gas plant is a permanent structure constructed underground with RCC. The cost of this plant is less and the durability is more. However, the fiber gas drum also remains perfect for 25 years. But the cost of construction is more. Of course, there is no difference in the method of production of the biogas and its usage with both of these models. Most of the state governments provide subsidy for these biogas plants. Many dairies produce vermicompost to earn an additional income. This is more profitable than selling the cow dung manure directly. We find both permanent vermicompost units as well as portable units of this type. Vermicompost gets ready for usage in 3 months. It sells for 5 to 6 rupees a kilogram. Popularity of organic farming created good demand for vermicompost. All these efforts earn an additional income for the dairy, helping it for early and better financial stability. Let us study a few major diseases of dairy animals now. The first one is mastitis. This bacterial disease can cause serious loss to the commercial usage of the milking animal. There are 3 major types of mastitis. The chance of this disease is more in high-yielding crossbred cows. Swelling of the udder may also be accompanied by high fever. Milking gives severe pain to the cow and watery liquid or curdy milk comes out. Otherwise, tiny white particles are seen in the milk. Blood mixed or rose-colored milk may also come out. The pathogen enters the udder through teat and pores in unhygienic cattle shed, and also in the case of incomplete milking. The udder muscle may turn black and start decaying if immediate and correct treatment is not given. Sometimes the affected part of the udder becomes useless permanently. Treat the mastitis with a competent veterinarian. Keep the floor of the cattle shed clean and dry always to prevent mastitis. Practice clean and complete milking. Foot and mouth is a contagious viral disease affecting all cleft-hoofed animals, both domestic and wild. High fever is the first symptom. In milking animals, the milk yield drops suddenly. The animal starts putting out saliva after 2 days. Vesicles appear in mouth, tongue, gums, and corners of the thigh. Later on, vesicles open up and become ulcers, oozing blood. Hence, the animal stops taking of food and water and suffers with pain. We can hear sound like chap-chap from the mouth. Wounds appear in the cleft of the hooves and maggots develop soon. In severe cases, hooves may detach from the legs. Normally, the animal will not die due to FMD disease, but the production drops up to 30 to 50%. Animal takes many months for the complete recovery. This contagious viral disease spreads to other animals through saliva, discharged liquids, milk, and moist air. There is no specific treatment for this disease except some symptomatic treatments. Separate the affected animal from the herd. Spray 2% solution of cooking soda to the wounds of the mouth and hooves. Applying honey to the mouth will give some relief from the pain. Give soft food like cooked ragi and jaggery water twice a day. Put soft green fodder. Apply neem oil to the wounds of the hooves to avoid maggots. Vaccinating all the animals yearly twice in January and July will prevent FMD. Hemorrhagic septicemia, or HS, is a contagious deadly respiratory disease caused by bacteria. This is common in cows, buffaloes, sheep, and goat. Affected animal stops taking food and water suddenly and faces difficulty in breathing. Swelling of lower portion of the neck is seen. This pathogen enters the body of the animal through polluted food and water. Later on, the disease spreads to the other animals of the herd. High fever and putting out of saliva is seen. In severe cases, the animal may die due to breathing problems in 12 to 24 hours. Treat the affected animal immediately by a competent veterinarian. To prevent HS disease, vaccinate all the animals once in a year. Black quarter is also a deadly bacterial disease affecting the animals, normally during the onset of monsoon. It mostly attacks well-grown animals below 2 years of age. The pathogen enters the body of the animal through polluted food and the wounds on the body. High fever, no intake of food and water, limping, and swelling of muscles of the limping leg, etc., are the symptoms. Pressing of the swollen muscle will produce char-char sound. The animal at this stage will die with pain within 12 to 24 hours. Treat the animal immediately. To prevent BQ disease, vaccinate all the animals yearly once. Brucellosis is another contagious bacterial disease. It may spread to humans also by consuming raw milk from the affected animal or by the contact with the secretion of the animal. Pregnant animal affected with brucellosis will abort the calf by 6 to 7 months. Fetal membrane will not come out completely and starts decaying, leading to the death of the animal. Separate the affected animal. Animal died due to brucellosis should be buried in a deep pit with lime powder and common salt. There is no effective medicine for the treatment of brucellosis till now. Vaccinate only the female calf against brucellosis only once in its lifetime at 6 to 9 months of its age. Milk fever is a physiological disorder affecting the cow within 72 hours of calving. High-yielding aged cows, especially the Jersey cows, are affected more. Depletion of high amount of calcium from the body through milk or deficiency of calcium in the food is the reason. Putting out of the tongue from the mouth, getting disturbed even with little noise, losing body balance, shivering, kicking back legs, low body temperature, etc. are the symptoms of milk fever. The cow lay down on the ground with debility. In severe cases, the animal enters unconsciousness and dies within few hours. Call the doctor immediately. He will inject the calcium liquid directly into the blood vein. Most of the animals recover immediately after the treatment. To avoid milk fever, feed the pregnant cow with balanced nutrition and the required quantity of mineral mixture. Do not milk the cow completely immediately after calving. Give 150 grams of calcium powder or 100 ml of calcium liquid through food once just after calving and once more after 12 hours. Treating these costly animals is also costly after it is affected by the disease. In addition, the animal will suffer with loss of growth and production. Hence, vaccinate all the animals twice a year against contagious foot and mouth disease and once against HS and BQ diseases. Keep the cattle shed clean. Give clean bath daily to the animals to avoid ticks. Put deworming medicine twice a year. Maintain enough cross ventilation in the shed. Provide clean drinking water and feed the fodder without any fungal contamination. Leave the stall-fed animals 2 hours a day for wandering in the paddock. Feed the animal with balanced cattle feed and fodder to keep it healthy. Do not bring sudden changes in the food. Keep up regular timing of various works on the dairy farm. Do not change the workers again and again. Personal cleanliness of the workers is also very important. Do not frighten the animals. Maintain calmness on the dairy farm. Growing trees around the farm will keep the premises cool. Treat the animals with a competent veterinarian immediately after noticing illness. It is better and safe to provide insurance coverage to these costly animals. General insurance companies extend this facility for the animals between 3 and 12 years of age. Putting this kind of tag is compulsory for the insured animal. Normally, the yearly insurance premium will be 4 to 5% of the value of the animal. The company will pay the insurance amount if the insured animal dies within the period of insurance. The dairy farmer must depend on an expert veterinarian for complex health problems. However, it is better if he is aware of first aid and treatments for simple illnesses. There are many useful home remedies or ethno-veterinary practices for the purpose. Now, let us list the health-related materials to be kept always in a dairy farm. Potassium permanganate. Put 2 tinges of this crystal to 1 liter of water and use it for washing the wounds. Bleaching powder. Use this to clean drinking water at the rate of 10 grams for 1,000 liters. It is useful even for cleaning floors of the cattle shed. Phenol, a germicide for cleaning the shed. Dettol, a germicide for cleaning the udder. Turpentine oil, use this to kill maggots in the wound. Iodine ointment, useful for applying to wounds. Tetracycline tablets, give 2 tablets twice a day in case of fever and diarrhea. Himalayan Batisa, it is useful for indigestion. Put 50 grams of this powder in jaggery and give twice a day. Neem oil, apply it for skin disease and for wounds to avoid maggots. Tick insecticide, useful to kill ticks and other ectoparasites. Antibiotic ointment, useful to apply on wounds. Camphor, fill the camphor powder in the wound to avoid maggots. Dear viewers, we have studied a lot of issues on daring in this documentary film. There is one last word left. Daring is a biological industry. We cannot consider the animal as a machine producing milk. We need to develop affection towards the cattle. We will come across many problems while managing this sensitive living stock. We have to nourish the cow properly as goddess Lakshmi, along with worshipping it as Govmata. Scientific attitude, proper planning, and involvement of the farmer will definitely bring success in this dairy industry. These innocent animals will never disappoint us if we manage them properly. Namaskar.